tester.co.uk.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the Fluke 115 TrueRMS multimeter. Now, I've had this multimeter for quite a while in my collection, but I haven't formally done a full review on it. So we're going to have a closer look at it. It's a fairly basic multimeter, certainly feels solid and robust, and hopefully is fairly safe to use. It is, however, quite expensive. You'll pay anything between $130 $140 for the 6,000 count multimeter that doesn't have a milliamp or microamp selection on it. So it might be quite questionable for a lot of people who are trying to get into, who are doing perhaps electrical or electronics work, want a good safe multimeter, but you're paying quite a high price for this little beast. So let's get onto the bench and have a closer look.
Right, so certainly the one thing off the bat to kind of note about this multimeter is that it, out of all the multimeters I have, this has to be one of the most solid feeling quality built externally, certainly, multimeters. It's got a good solid feel in the hand. The plastics are very nice feel to the selector switch. It's got the arrangement where you can actually use one hand to kind of use the, or make selections with the selector dial, while you've obviously got potentially probes in the other doing something. Perhaps a dangerous situation to be in, but nonetheless, they've got it catered for single-handed operation. It does have this nice solid yellow external boot that it comes in, the rubber housing. It is TrueRMS. It has a hold button. It's not a touch hold. It just freezes the, or holds the display. It's got a min-max and average. We'll double check that, but a nice feature to have on here. It's got a manual range switch. Yellow button is for the second function on some of these selections. And then it does have a backlight. As you'll note, it's only got three inputs, so it's got a common, a what is for a voltage, resistance, continuity, capacitor, diode, and then for current. Up to a 10 amp range, it can go, I think, 20 amp for a few seconds, but it's obviously missing milliamp, microamp. So that's the one point to note about this multimeter in this price bracket. That certainly is a pity that that's missing. On the back, it certainly has a very nice standing bail with it on it, which is really handy. It has noted the power on features. So if you hold down the min-max button, you can disable the beeper. If you hold down, I presume that must be the orange select button, it'll disable the auto power off, and they can disable the light off as well. It talks about auto voltage detection and low impedance, but that's on the 114, 116 and 117. It's not on this model. So it does have a nice standing bail. Reasonably stable on that. And you can obviously do single-handed changes without having to actually hold the meter itself. The display, now here's where it gets interesting. I'm holding it at an angle to the camera now where you'll probably see fairly nice, clear, crisp digits. It's certainly a nice size. I like the kind of glass that they got to the display. It's got nice, solid quality feel to it. But if I put the meter down like that, I'll think you agree it looks a little bit, the contrast looks a bit not the best and washed out. And this is something I've noted certainly now in comparison with my other meters. And someone, I think, did note that over time, the display seemed to be washed out. So I don't know whether it's an issue with time, as I obviously don't have a new one to compare with it, but just something to be wary of. It is a bit washed out. If you've got it on the standing bail, I'll just put it in front of my eyes. Also, at the angle I'm seeing it at, it does not look that crisp, which is a pity. I don't know whether it's a function of time or whether it was originally like that. Right, and in terms of the test leads that it comes with, I'm assuming these are the original ones it comes with. I've looked through all my leads just to make sure I don't have another set, and I don't think so. They are silicone, nice, soft quality leads. I must say, I've always been impressed by the leads that do come with the Flukes. These are rated for 1000 volt Cat 2. The actual meter itself, just to note, is rated for Cat 3 600 volt. But certainly no complaints with the quality and feel. They are rubberized, nice to hold in the hand, nice points. They do have a little bit of strain relief at the ends here, so they shouldn't fatigue that early. There isn't much strain relief on at the other end, however, but certainly all the plugs and everything, a good quality feel. The actual receiving banana sockets are solid inside, so again, a nice good build, but we'll have a closer look at that once we get inside it. Right, so the first test we're going to do, I've got it on the variable power supply. The specs note that this is, first of all, it updates at 4 times per second for the main display and 32 times per second for the bar graph, which seem like respectable figures. It's also noted as a 0.5% accuracy on DC voltage, plus 2 counts if I recall. So let's just turn up the voltage and have a look. So what I'm going to do first is just take it steadily up to the 6 volt mark, where we should obviously retain our 3 digits. Yep, for as a 6,000 count, and at some point it'll drop down to 2. And I would say that update speed is certainly doing at least a 3 or 4, so that's certainly respectable for a little meter like this. Let's just go all the way up. Okay, so there's the limit of my power supply. We'll come back down. Let's get to a region where the actual bar graph is a little more sensitive, and that is a really nice update, smooth representation on that bar graph. I must say, a lot of the meters you sometimes find it's very sticky, but I must say I really like the way that works. Right, the next test we're going to do is to see if there's any overshoot. So I'm going to leave it at this value, 3.658, switch off the output to my power supply, bang. No, let's just have a look again. It goes virtually straight there, so it's not, doesn't, there doesn't seem to be any overshoot at that range. Let's just for fun take it to something higher. Let's take it to 30 volts on my power supply, just make sure it doesn't overshoot there. No, so it goes an over limit and then displays a value, which is great. We're going to take it into a manual range just to see how it behaves there. And I can't complain with that. On a previous multimeter, you recall when I did that, it seemed to like clock up. So certainly no complaints with overshoot. Right, next we're going to check the accuracy. So I've got it connected to my Pentaref. I've got it at this point in time in DC volts. And because of the resolution for this reading, what we're going to do, it should be reading 0.2499. I'm going to take it down to millivolts. It's just make sure it's actually defaulted. Something to note, on the mini millivolts, it defaults to AC. So there we go. So now we've got millivolts DC. It's odd. I would have thought that have actually defaulted to DC on the millivolts. But nonetheless, so here we go. It is, you certainly can't complain with that figure. It's only very slightly out. We're going to go to the next reading, which we obviously going to over limit, and it should be 1.5, and it's exactly 1.5. 5 volt reference. Let's just see if it settles. It's twiggling on the last figure, but certainly well within its specification. 7.75, spot on. 9.95, spot on. Right, next we're going to the DMM check plus. On the 5 volt DC reference, that's fine. We're now going to check it on the AC side. So I'm flicking to AC, going to the AC voltage selection. It should be reading 4.999. Let's just see if it does settle in. Right, so I've just given it a bit of time to settle, and at this reading you can see it's a little bit out. It should be at 4.999, but the spec for AC volts is 1%. And that 1%, it can afford to be like 5 counts out on the second digit. So it's still well within its specified rating. Right, next, a simple switch. We're going to measure the frequency. Push the yellow button so it measures hertz, and it should be at 99.995. And it's twiddling about there, but no complaints on that measurement. Right, so next we're going to measure DC current. So I've got the selector down here to amps. Perhaps what we want to double check is if I take that out, what happens if we go to the voltage? It doesn't give an audio. You see it actually said lead over there. I just want to check that again. Interesting. It kind of flicks up and says lead, but it doesn't give a constant audible warning that you might be in the wrong socket. Okay, so it's something, but so as I said, the one thing that's obviously sorely lacking of this meter is the ability to measure milli or microamp. So you can measure milliamp just about on the main 10 amp current scale. And on my reference here, we're measuring one milliamp, and I can't complain because it is showing a 1, but obviously no further resolution on that. Let's just go to the AC side to see if it's picking up anything, and it should be showing at least 1.0, but of course down this end with the resolution, it's probably not going to see it. Right, we're just about to do the resistance checks. I did have, here we go, so I had the leads together here, and as you can see, there is a 0.1 ohm resistance in the leads. It doesn't have a relative button, so I can't delta that out, so just to note that. Right, we're on the 100 ohm resistor, which should read 100.05, and it doesn't go down to that resolution, and again, for the resolution and accuracy, you can't complain where it is at the moment. On the 1K resistor, it should be measuring 1.000, which is where it's sitting. For the 10K, it should be at 10.00, which is where it is. For the 100K, it should be at 100.1, which again is exactly where it is. Right, next we're going to have a look at the diode test. In the stats, in the specifications, it does state it can test up to 2 volts. So we'll take a simple diode. This one, as I recall, is a Schottky diode, so the forward bias voltage drop should be fairly low. And yes, and it's measuring it fine, and it's got a little annotation on there showing that it's measuring diode. Next we'll check a red LED, and it's able to show the drop across that. I have noted, although you won't be able to see perhaps in the camera, it perhaps just slightly, it does just manage to illuminate it, but it's showing the drop across it. So 1765. Green LED. Again, I don't know if you'll notice it in the camera, it does just manage to put some illumination on there. 1781. I've got a blue LED, and that you can actually see quite relatively clearly, but it's unable to provide enough voltage to do the drop. So let's actually just measure what it is actually testing with. So here we go, I've pulled in another multimeter, and we're just going to measure the voltage. And it's actually using 2.4 volts. It's saying in the spec 2, but it's got 2.4. So a reasonable diode tester. Right, next we'll check the capacitance measurement. I've got this capacitor of 50 microfarad. I've got some electrolytics, and I've got this capacitor over here of 2.2 nanofarad. That's right at the bottom of what this can measure. So we won't expect much there, but let's put them on and see what we get. Right, so the 2.2, and fair enough at the resolution and the kind of tolerances, is showing up as flicking between 2 and 3, so that's fair enough. Next I have a 1 microfarad electrolytic, and that's coming up as 919 nano, so no problem there. Next I'm doing the 15 microfarad, and that's coming up with no problem. Next I have the 1000 microfarad, and that's coming up as 965, so again within tolerance of both the capacitor and the meter itself. Then we'll do the bigger fella, the 4700. And there we go, a little bit of a wait, but nonetheless it's come up with a figure, and again within the tolerance of the capacitor and the spec of the multimeter, can't complain about that. Right, next we're going to check the continuity buzzer. So I've got the leads in. It's certainly a latched continuity buzzer, so that works very well. and it works very quickly. Certainly with most Fluke meters, there's no complaint with a good latching continuity tester. Right, the next feature I'm going to demonstrate is the min-max average feature which this has. Before we get to that, I just want to quickly demonstrate the backlight. If I put the backlight on, you'll see it just lightly illuminates the back. So it certainly would be adequate for a dark place. It does tend to have a bit of a hot spot, but nonetheless, it's in a dark, darkened room, it would certainly be adequate. Right, then I've got my variable power supply attached. I'm going to flick on the min-max button, which brings up that little min-max annotation over there. And the first reading it's showing you is the max. So as I turn up, you'll hear it bleats, it records. As I go down, it's holding that value. Push again, you get the minimum. As I'm going down, it's got the minimum. Push again, it's giving you an average over time, which, as I said, I find a very useful feature, because you can, if you've, although this doesn't show you the time, if you are noting the time, you could work out consumption with this if you're measuring current. So I'll flick it again, then you get to your live reading, what's being displayed. Now, there is one thing to note with this min-max feature. I'm going to come back out of it. So if I flick again, you go back to the max. Hold the button down, you come back to normal readings. I'm going to go down to a low reading down here. I'm going to go into min-max. Now I'm going to turn my power supply past a point. I've got up to 10 volts, and you can see it's over limit. It doesn't auto range when you are in your min-max. That's something important to note. Some multimeters do, this one doesn't. So you'd have to come out, and in the range, you have to kind of note the range you expect to have your readings, and then go into the mode there, so at least you're not going to be over limit. Right, the next thing we'll just have a look at is the ability to measure frequency. So I've got it connected up to my function generator. It's a 5-volt peak-to-peak sine wave I'm feeding into it. It does say it can go up to 50 kilohertz. We'll obviously test that, but I have got it down to 1 hertz, and it certainly can measure that, which is really great. Look, if you look at the bar graph, it looks as though the bar graph does obviously react to the actual input signal, which makes sense. So let's just step it up. We're going to take it up to, let's just zip it up, and it seems to respond fairly quickly and settle. And right on the nose, I've got it on 12 at the moment. Let's just go up to, let's go to 50 hertz. What I'm going to go do is just change the next digit down, 50.1. It's got that. I'm going to go to something arbitrary, 50.6. It's got that. I'm going to try the next digit, 61. It's got that. I'm going to go to 67. Heavens, I must say, it's responding really well in terms of the counter inside. Going down to that resolution, spot on according to my function generator. Okay, so let's round that out. I'm going to go up to 60 hertz for you in the States, and then we'll start stepping it up from there. Let's go to 120. There we go. Step it up, 130, 147, 437, still showing spot on. I'm going to go to something a bit higher, 20 kilohertz. You can see the annotation down here. I'm just going to see if it's still got the resolution, 0.1, yeah. Yeah, exactly what's on my scope, so no problem there. Let's just go to 30 and start stepping it up from there. Remember, 50 is the top end. 42 exactly. 46. 50. There we go. So now I'm going over the spec. So I must say, I'm really impressed to date out of the kind of multimeters I've checked, which have either kind of fluttered around or not been able to cope. This has been able to go down to the resolution and respond very quickly. So just for fun, let's just see where it does fall over. I'm at 100. Ah, there we go. Okay, so at 100, 99, it's showing it. It's a for fun step up on the, yeah, it's showing exactly what's on my function generator. And there it goes, no complaints there.
Right, so let's just summarize so far what the tiny testing has revealed. I think the build quality in the field is certainly very good. The way the rotary switch goes around works well. I like the fact that it's got the min-max average. It's got a good continuity tester. All the readings seem to work very well. Where it's lacking, again, sorely, is that it doesn't have milliamp or microamp. The frequency measurement on there certainly is very good. I was well impressed the first time I've gone and checked that, so that's worked out okay. But for the price point, for a 6,000 count multimeter lacking milliamp, microamp, that's probably the biggest sore point, and also the display. As I say, I can't recall whether it was clearer, but certainly it seems to be, you have to have it at the right angle for it to be work well. I don't know whether that's something to do with age, something you might want to research. In part two of the review, we'll actually open it up, have a look inside, check the fuses, the build quality, the power consumption and the low battery warning, and then we'll do the mains measurements as well. So I'll catch you soon for part two. Cheers.
Tester.co.uk